Thy grace should be evident as it has been so many times before. We look to thee in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, thank you for coming. Good to see everyone. One thing I've learned is not to count numbers, not to worry about numbers. Many years ago at Goodwood, we were at the little assembly in Goodwood up here. With fear and trembling, I got enough nerve to ask the great Mr. Harold Paisley to come and preach there one night. A few country folk gathered, and I thought, I hope he's not disappointed. He got up to speak, and he looked around, and he said, I'll speak as if there was 400 here. And he did. He did okay. Another time I learned about numbers, we were visiting in the prison, and the numbers were going down and down in the gospel work there. I was getting kind of discouraged, you know, there's 450 men in the prison, and instead of 15 or 20 coming to the service, it got down to a few, and it got down to maybe two or three, and I was wondering, well, maybe we shouldn't come, maybe we should do something different. And so I said that to them one night, you know, should we not come? Do you don't want us to come, or what? Well, there was one dear man who was there on a life sentence. And he stopped me after and he looked at me and he said, would you not come if I was the only one? And somehow it stopped. I didn't know what to say. And I almost heard as if the Lord was saying, I went all the way to Samaria for one woman at the well. So I looked at him and I said, of course we'll come. We'll come every time. And we did. We came every time after that. And there was more gathered as the months went by. But a little challenges like that come along sometimes. So we don't count numbers per se, and we're just encouraged day by day as what we can do. So for a few minutes tonight, I'd like to study something and share with you some of the highlights of the year. But first of all, we're going to read in the Old Testament. I think I have to read in English. I think Josh said I have to preach in English. I thought maybe I'd do tonight in Lunda, but I guess maybe I better not. You probably wouldn't get it anyway. But you know, it's really nice for us to sit here and listen to all the English prayers, because for the last long time, every prayer meeting we're at, they're all Lunda. They're all or Luvawi speaking. And so all the prayers, you're not really understanding 100% of what they're saying. You're sort of guessing your way through. So it's really nice to be here and listen to all the brothers praying. So in the Old Testament book of Isaiah, we're going to read a few verses. The book of Isaiah. And I think you probably know where I'm going to go. Chapter 40, Isaiah chapter 40. And for those at home, I hope they're picking up, because I've heard sometimes they don't hear very well. So I think Andrew's on the adjustments back there, so hopefully I'll try to remember to talk so this can be heard for those who want to listen at home. So Isaiah chapter 40, we're going to read a few verses that are very well known to us, but can speak to us again tonight. We're going to read verses 28 to 31. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 28 to 31. Hast thou not heard? Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fail. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Now the Lord will bless this little reading and some lessons we can learn from it. Interesting, he gives us three powerful word pictures here. One is an eagle, and in Zambia we have two very lovely eagles that we like to see. One is a Batalur eagle, the other is a fish eagle, and their wingspan is probably almost 6 feet, and to watch them is amazing, to see them soaring. And you think, that's what Isaiah had in mind, the eagle. He's up there. He's above all the mundane things of earth. But an eagle is known for vision. They can see that tiny little mouse down there, or that fish. If it's a fish eagle, they do fishing. And they swoop down from way up high, and they'll grab a fish in the river and take off with a fish in their claws. So the three word pictures, the first one, the eagle, is known for vision. Known for vision. The second one is the runner. And he's known, in this story, this reading, it's about a tireless runner. I don't know about you, but I like watching runners as they run. When I was in collegiate, I remember watching runners go around a track. I didn't do it that well, but others did. And to watch them run, I remember watching one year the 26-mile marathon. And one of our students actually at that school won it. And to watch him going around and around that track for so long, I thought, how does he do it? Tireless. He had the energy. He had the power to do it. And the word picture he's giving here is the tireless runner, not distracted, but focused. And the third word picture is someone walking or someone determined, like a pilgrim. He's determined to get there, and he's going to get there eventually, like a pilgrim. So how do we do this? How does this work? I think every one of us feels sometimes bogged down with day-to-day work, day-to-day family, day-to-day health issues, the weather. All these things kind of pull us down, weigh us down, and we get discouraged and we feel down and think, oh, how could I ever soar like an eagle and see it from a different perspective, to see it from above? And that's what he's trying to say here. They that wait upon the Lord. It's the idea of thinking about the Lord, relying upon the Lord, waiting for the Lord, if you like, waiting on the Lord, if you like. And he's talking there about renewing their strength. What it's saying is, you don't have strength. We're weak. The word there is the idea of exchanging. He's taking your weakness and inability and giving you strength and energy. That's the word picture he's giving. So it's very easy for us to get bogged down, to get discouraged, to get weary. Sunday school teachers get weary. Elders get weary. Parents get tired and weary of life and all the things that they have to deal with and tell the children over and over again. And it's easy to get pulled down to a point that you get discouraged and down and feeling low. And so these verses are very applicable today, just like they were back then when they were written. Very much so. You know, I remember Mr. Creary. Some of you remember him. He had a bookstore, old Mr. Creary. And he told me one time a story, and I never forgot it. Sometimes you get weary doing the same thing over and over again. And he was one who used to pick up children. I think he was in Lansing years ago. And he would pick up children for children's meetings. He was praying about children's meetings here tonight. And he was getting weary sometimes because this one fellow used to come in his car, and he was always rude. He was always loud. He always smelled bad. And he put his gum on the seat, and he put his boots on the back of the chair. And Mr. Creary said to me once, I was almost praying he wouldn't come. I got tired of him. He was a brat. He was a real troubled kid. I was tired of him. But he says, I kept picking him up year after year for children's meetings. And then one day, 30 years later, he got a call from Nova Scotia, I think it was. He got a call on the phone. Mr. Creary, my name is so-and-so. Do you remember me? And he goes, oh, no. What does he want now? And you know what that man said? He said, Mr. Creary, I want to thank you for taking me to Sunday school and putting up with me. I just got saved. You see? He persevered. He kept at it. He didn't give up. He could have. Humanly speaking, he should have. But he kept at it. He kept going. And so that's the idea here. We can't always change our circumstances, but we can change our attitude in the circumstance. Isn't that interesting? How we think. And I think that's the idea of the eagle here too. He's soaring above the earth, above the problems, above the difficulties. Doesn't mean he doesn't see them, but he has a different perspective of them. You know, Christians aren't exempt from the problems of life and difficulties of life. They're not. When you're saved, he doesn't remove you from everything. But he's there with you in everything. There's a huge difference. And so as you go through issues of life, as you go through circumstances you wish didn't happen, he's there with you. And so our attitude can change. Our attitude can change as we think here about his infinite ability and where our help can come from. It's much easier to bear a burden if we know that he's going to help us with it. His infinite wisdom, his infinite ability is there. And he's willing to carry it with us and be there for us. Oftentimes we feel like we don't have the joy or we don't have the victory over the temptations and difficulties of life. And we sit kind of with our feet up and thinking, this is kind of a bad day. Didn't go very well today. And Satan comes in and discourages. And somehow we've lost our vision. We've lost our joy. Do Christians get like that? They do. Believe me, they do. And things drain us. Phone calls come. Issues are coming to us. And you have to deal with them. And you feel drained. But with God's help, we can be like the eagle and lift above and see it from a different perspective. Do we long for that thrill? Do we long for that knowledge? Do we long for that joy of feeling the Lord near us and helping us? So a change of attitude is important, of how we see things and how we perceive what's going on. 4 points. I was looking at this earlier today and I was thinking, 4 points, that's dear Mr. Dryberg. We always had 4 points about everything. Point number one, do not blame God for your problem. That's a big one. People do that, you know. And we have examples in the Bible. Think of Mary and Martha. What did they say to the Lord Jesus? If you were here, this wouldn't have happened. It's your fault. Were they blaming him? They were. If you had been here, they both said it. If you had been here, this wouldn't have happened. And people, we do that. We get in a situation, something goes wrong, and we think, Lord, what have we done? We've tried to be faithful. Why are we being punished? What is happening? See, Mary and Martha were like that. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. They were blaming God. We're not always thankful for things that happen bad, things that hurt. But we can be thankful in the situation, not for it. You see the difference? The disciples, when they're in the boat, he didn't take them out of the storm. He left them in the storm, but he went where they were. He was with them. See, Daniel wasn't removed from the den of lions, but God was with him in the den of lions. And that's the same with you and the same with me. When the difficulties come, when the problems are there, when the trials are there, we can't always be thankful for the pain, but we can be thankful for the one who's with us in the pain. I think that's what he's getting at. So do not blame God. Mary and Martha were there. You know, I kind of like Martha, actually. Here she was trying to make a nice dinner for the Lord. And she's working hard. And again, she comes to the Lord and says, don't you care? Can't you see I'm doing all the work? And there's my sister. She's doing nothing. That sounds legitimate. That's human, isn't it? Wouldn't we feel the same way? But you know, there was a lesson coming. Was there anything wrong with what Martha was doing? Absolutely nothing. The meal was beautiful, I'm sure. The dishes she was troubled with were there. The problem was her attitude when she was doing the dishes, the food, preparing those dishes. That was the problem. It was what she was allowing those things to trouble her. He says, you're troubled about many dishes. I think King James says things. Other versions say dishes. She had a number of things. She wanted to do it right and wanted to have a nice meal. And there was nothing wrong with that. But she allowed those ordinary things to trouble her. And she was missing the good part that Mary was enjoying. You see? It was all about attitude, isn't it? But the Lord had a reason. And he had them exactly where he wanted them. and he had something coming that was huge, resurrection. So, number one, don't blame God. Number two, if we're going to fly like the eagle, run tirelessly like the runner, and walk with vision like the walker, like the pilgrim, don't compare. Number two, don't compare. It's so easy for us to see someone else with more than we have. I wish I had the ability of so-and-so to preach. I wish I could visit like so-and-so. I wish I had the money like so-and-so. I wish I looked as good as Mrs. So-and-so. We all do that. We compare ourselves with other people. And you know, unhappiness always begins with comparison. Instead of thanking God for who you are, where you are, and what you're like right now. Be yourself. He doesn't expect you to be someone else. That's why we're all different. God didn't make robots. He made us all individuals and different. So unhappiness begins with comparison. We start comparing. You know, when I see a young fellow roaring down the road in a Ferrari, I kind of think, where have I been? You know? Or some luxurious Maybach. I followed one the other day, a few months ago, in Lusaka, by the way. A Maybach, which is like a Rolls Royce. I thought, how did they get that here? What are they doing with that? You know, what am I doing wrong? But I try not to compare. So unhappiness begins with comparison. Our responsibility is to serve the Lord with who we are, where we are, and what we have. Doesn't mean we can't improve, but to love others with the abilities you have. I said to someone here recently, they were talking about their experiences of life, and I said, the Lord has allowed them in your life so that you can use those experiences to share with someone else and meet them in their need and what they're going through. On Sunday, a lady was talking to me about her wayward daughter this past Sunday. And it just kind of broke my heart to think that I remember that child, a lovely person, and now rebellious and doesn't want to come to Sunday school or to the meeting and all the things she was doing. Heartbreaking to the parent. I said, just keep loving her. Just keep reaching out to her. Just keep forgiving. It's not easy. I said, be the mom. Be solid. Be sincere. Keep the rules. I said, I have a house full of teenage girls. I know what it's like. She said, oh, do you? I said, oh, yeah. So she needed encouragement. Where she was difficult, but God could use her in that situation. So, number one was don't blame God. Number two, don't compare. Number three, don't excuse the present because of the past. People do that too, you know. They say things like, well, I was born this way. I grew up this way. I can't help it. I was taught this way. And they're defeated because of some mistake they made in their past. No one here is exempt from mistakes. We've all made mistakes. But those blunders keep coming to your mind. Satan keeps bringing them to you and saying, you're a failure. You can't do anything right. Look at you. And we somehow are defeated in the present because of what happened in the past, what we've done. I never was good at it, we say. My upbringing was bad. My parents didn't treat me right. And on we can go with excuses. But that was then. This is now. I sometimes say to the young people, I said, there's three words in Christian life when you're trying to move forward, forgetting about the past. You know what the three words are? Get over it. Get over it. Just leave it behind. Paul had to do that. Do you think Paul had an easy past in the things he used to do? And what did he say? Forgetting the things behind, I press forward to what is ahead. He was willing to move forward and move ahead and leave those things behind him. Do you think he could have got bogged down in all the persecution he gave to the Christians at the time? Of course he could have. It could have really troubled him. And I'm sure it did in some ways. But he writes in Philippians 3, forgetting those things which are behind, I press toward the mark of the upcalling of God. So trying to lose those things and leave them behind. Don't excuse where you are today with your past. Leave the past behind. Don't bring it forward. Don't bring it with you. He was willing to look ahead. It's better ahead. He was willing to focus on what was ahead. Number four. And then I'll give you some updates of the year to pray about. Number four, if we're going to soar like the eagle, if we're going to run tirelessly, and if we're going to walk like the pilgrim, we can't live an if-only life. If only. And we've all done that too. If only I had a bigger assembly. If only I had better teaching. If only I had a better job. If only I had different friends. If only I lived in a different neighborhood. If only my children were better. And we go on like that, don't we? If only I had more degrees and more education. We need to learn contentment. Paul said contentment. Godliness with contentment is great gain. You know, I learned a lesson a number of years ago. We went visiting a small assembly in a very rural location, very rural. Most of the people came to the meeting with no shoes. They didn't have any. A lot of times their shirts had no buttons. They just didn't have any. Very, very poor. And I got up to speak through an interpreter at this little assembly. Oh, and when the box came around, you know, your collection box, they had a box. But you know, at the end of the day, it was empty. There was absolutely nothing in it. No one had anything. Nothing. Very, very poor. And I looked at their faces. I'm looking down at this whole little meeting full of people. No backs on the chairs, just the little benches they were sitting on. And they were all smiling. All of them. And I thought to myself, here's a little meeting. There was no windows, like it was just a hole. A grass roof. They only had water for the emblems and a cookie because they didn't have bread. They didn't know what wine was. They'd never seen a grape in their life. Doing their best in the bush. And yet I looked at their faces and I thought, they're content. They're all smiling. They didn't know about cell phones and flush toilets and all the conveniences that we know. They'd never seen any of that kind of thing. But they were content. Why? The secret was this: they knew the Lord. That was it. They were enjoying the Lord. Most of them didn't have a watch. They didn't start the meeting till we got there. They didn't care what time it was. Whenever you get there, that's when we'll start. Because like I said, what time do we come? It doesn't matter. Come anytime you want. When you come, we'll start. And they never looked at their watch through the meeting. You know how sometimes we get bored in a meeting and we start to look at our watch like, when is this over? Huh? They never did that because they didn't have a watch. They just listened as we talked from the Word of God. But the contentment was there, and that taught me something. You don't have to have a lot to be content. They had very, very little, and yet they were content. They accepted what God had given them, the gift of salvation, and they enjoyed it. Life expectancy was short in some of those bush areas. So not very many were old. When I move in those circles, I feel like probably the oldest one there, believe it or not. So health is not always good. Some of them never went to school, no education. And yet the smiles on their faces, they were content. What a great thing for us to learn is contentment. And to be thankful for what God has given you. Every Christian has a gift. I know we say, oh, Mr. So-and-so, he's very gifted. That brother, he's gifted. That sister, she can do this and this, she's gifted. But you know, I think every Christian has a gift. The Holy Spirit gives gifts on demand. As soon as you're saved, you have a gift, a spiritual gift. I remember saying to old Stanley Sims, I think you remember Stanley Sims, he used to come and visit me when I was a young believer in the early 80s, I guess it was. We were not married, only 10 years or so. And he used to kind of get after me and try to encourage me about stirring up your gift. And I remember saying to him, I don't have one. I don't do anything well. And you know what he said to me? He said, find it. He said, you find it. It's there. Of course you have one, he said. You have to find it. Try things. Work. It'll come. So I couldn't give him any excuses. He wouldn't listen. He said, you just keep coming to the meeting. Come. Be there. Learn. exercise your gift. At that time, I said they didn't have one. So being thankful to God and not using the excuse, if only I had something different. If only I had more money, I could give more. You ever thought like that? You know, some of the greatest givers had nothing. The widow is recorded in Scripture of giving everything. 2 pennies, if you like, or 2 mites. Very little. But it's recorded in the Holy Scriptures as a lot. So it's not about amount. It's about attitude. So don't ever think if you had more, you'd do more. Mm-mm. Be content with what God has given you. The gifts you have, use them. Let God shape you and mold you into what he wants you to be. Be thankful for who you are. Be thankful for the gifts you do have and use them for his glory. And allow him to grow you as a Christian, to grow. I remember the first time Gary spoke in this hall, the very first time I was here. And that's a long time ago. And his brother spoke the same night. You think God has done something in our lives since then? Of course. We thank him. He's worked, allowing us to grow and learn things and share things with others. So don't be afraid of adversity. Some people like to have a smooth road, everything going smooth, and not have trouble. Here's the ABCs of spiritual growth. Adversity builds character. We try and teach our young people all the time. It's not about beauty. It's not about what you have. It's about your character. ABC, adversity builds character. So thank the Lord in the adversity. Maybe not for it, but in it. That he's helping you, he's shaping you, he's growing you. You're learning. You're trying to be content and show others what it means to know the Lord. Now, I had 3 or 4 more pages of stuff, but I think I'll stop there because we've only got a few minutes left, and I promised to give you a few highlights of the year in the work that we do or try to do. So we trust that those few verses will help us as we think of the 4 points to consider in relation to flying with the eagle and running with the runner tirelessly and walking as a pilgrim. May the Lord help us to do that. Now, just a few highlights of the year. In teaching our young people spiritual growth, I showed Janet a picture the other night of 2 young ladies who got saved this year. Now, again, we don't count heads. That's God's work. We try to be faithful with the word of God, and if 2 get saved or 100 get saved, it's up to him. We don't count are you successful or not successful if some get saved or some don't. It's up to him to save, isn't it? So we're to be faithful. Anyway, two got saved, 1 grade 10, 1 grade 11, and we just saw them coming to the meeting, the gospel meeting, week after week after week. We didn't know who they were, and eventually they got saved and told the assembly they trusted the Lord. Well, I found out afterwards that in their class was one of our BBG girls, Bailey's boarding girls, BBG. And Alina was in their class. And they told me, they said, well, she told us about the Lord. She told us the way of salvation. She told us there was a gospel meeting. And Gail's been trying to teach them, if you're a Christian, you should grow. You should show it by your life to other people. And they kind of wonder, well, what can I do? I'm just a student, I'm a girl, what can I do? Well, you can reach out to other people. And little did we know that one of them was doing that all year. And eventually her friends started coming to the assembly, and eventually they got saved. So that's on the good news file. Now, as of today, I was in touch with 2 of our girls. One is starting university next week. The other one is in university already for a year. And we have 6 right now in college or university, which is quite rare, because years ago, when we first arrived in the area, about 30% of students were girls. Now it's about 50%, about half boys, half girls. So over the years, the females have seen more and more need to be educated, more and more reason to be educated, and not start having families early and remaining in the village. So this is quite rare to have 6 of our girls in college and university at the present, Because years ago, if we saw one out of the whole school every 5 years go to college, it was like a miracle if one got to college or university. It was rare, very, very rare. But today, the need of education is understood, and more are going. And so ours, we encourage them after they finish grade 12, if they get good marks, we try to give them some money towards school and help them a little bit to get to college and university. So we have 6 actually right now in that position. The other thing we've been teaching them to reach out to others, these young people, is to help old people. There are some old people, probably not even as old as me, but they look old and they act old. And there was an old grandma in the village, and they said to me one Saturday, they said, we want to go down and sweep for her and cook her lunch and do some cleaning and do some laundry and so on. So 3 of them wanted to go. I said, sure, you can go. And they had to walk, I don't know how many kilometers down there. And I said, I'll tell you what, if you go in the morning, and by the afternoon you'll be tired at 4 o'clock, I'll come and pick you up with the car so you don't have to walk both ways. And that was something they thought on their own to do as a Christian outreach, to reach out to other people and help them in their time of need. So that was really exciting for us to see those things happen. Not only those 2 girls got saved, but there was also 2 boys got saved this year. Also, schoolboys. One of the young men from the assembly was gathering around his little house, and he was actually reaching out to them, and they got saved as well. Usually, if someone gets saved in the assembly meetings, eventually they'll tell the elders, and then they'll make an announcement. These 2 got saved, and then people try to help them then and encourage them and teach them and so on afterwards, so it's known. Our grade 12s, we always take out for lunch every year. I've had 2 seasons since I've been here in Oshawa, so we had 4 the year before and 2 this year that we took out for lunch. And you might not think it's very exciting to go out for lunch, but if you've never been out for lunch, it's really exciting. So we take them to a lodge and we sit down to a nice meal, and it's served. They don't have to do the work to make it and clean it up. They have someone else bring it. So it's quite exciting for them to have a lunch outing for the end of the year to celebrate their grade 12 graduation. We like to hear our young people say that they know the Lord. We don't try to put words in their mouth, and we don't force them to say anything, but once in a while, one of them will say whether they know the Lord or not. Now, the home that we have, it's easy for anyone to build a home and put people in it, give them a meal and a bed, but that's not really our focus. Our focus is that they might know the Lord, that they might be saved. That's our reason for being there. That's our reason for these girls coming from various places. We live the gospel and we preach the gospel to them regularly. We have Bible studies with them every week on a Friday night, and we always go through the various portions of scripture and always bring the gospel clearly. So there's no excuse to any of them to not know the Lord. But one such girl in Gail's class, I was sitting at the back, and she was talking about going to heaven and knowing the Lord for sure, and trying to spell it out again clearly. And some of the BBG girls go to her class, and then others from the community come as well. But one of them, when she was talking, I heard them say, I'm going. I'm going to heaven. I'm going. I'm sure I'm going. So I thought, oh, okay, that's interesting. So I quizzed her out on it later in the day. And she said, yeah, I'm saved. I was baptized at my home church across the river many miles away on the school break. So we didn't have to teach their baptism. They knew about that already. So it's good when they come forward and say they know the Lord. We're really excited to hear them come forward and say that. Some, we have not heard them say anything. We don't force them to go to the meetings, even at the assembly. One of our girls was going to the Catholic Church, actually, and one day she came back with a rosary necklace with a crucifix in plastic. They don't give out metal ones in a poor country. They give out plastic ones. So she had this little plastic crucifix. So when she came with it, I said, oh, what's that? Of course, I knew what it was. She said, that's Jesus. I said, yeah, uh-huh. I says, is it important to have Jesus on a stick like that on a jewelry, or is it more important to have him in your heart? Oh, she says, no, it's important to have him in your heart. This is just to remind us what he did. So, you see, they already knew the gospel. They knew what was important, and maybe they were saved already, and yet they still would go to a church like that. But the man who actually is in charge of that place is professing to be a Christian. He's a believer, believe it or not. And many of our children that have gone to that church are very well versed in scripture and do very well in the RE program, probably our best students. So The Lord can bless his work in various places and various ways. I still am a board chairperson there for the last 15 years, and it's not an easy job, but it does have opportunities. We have 650 pupils in the whole school and about 32 teachers. So as board chair, what I'm doing a lot of times, I'm looking at the various classes, talking to teachers, trying to make sure they're doing their job. If there's a discipline issue, I'm there in the office. There's opportunities and responsibilities that come. We keep prayer in all our school functions. There's prayer before and prayer after. We keep Scripture Union in the school, which is a program during school time of Scripture teaching, like a children's meeting, singing, memory verse, Bible verses, and a Bible lesson, and so on. So it gives me the opportunity to kind of keep things going in that way. If it got to be political, I would say, no, I'm not interested. I can't be bothered with that. But up till now, it's been very good in sense of reaching the students and the teachers with the gospel perspective. So I still continue to do that and am responsible for a lot of the events at school. Building projects we're kind of involved with sometimes, discipline issues with students or teachers and so on. So Scripture Union at school this year, we've noticed our girls actually from the BBG home, which is right beside the school, have actually taken a real interest in this program. I didn't ask them to, but when the day comes, they're always there with the hymn books and Bibles ready, and they'll find a room, a classroom that's vacant, and we'll set up in a classroom. And so it's really exciting to see that they're taking that initiative and that responsibility. So we pray that the Lord is actually working in their lives and in their hearts, and that they truly know the Lord. One day the headmaster called me from the office some months ago now, and he said, there's four people in the office, I need you to come. I said, okay. I came to the office, and here was two women, actually there was five people, there was a boy as well, and two girls. He said, they've traveled 2 days by ox cart from way across the river and way down to the Losey Kingdom area, and they heard that you had a Christian home, and they wanted you to accept them in your home. So I said, okay. Interesting. We did have space at the time. So I said, let's see your marks. They had their papers with them. And I thought, I'm a little suspicious sometimes when the marks look that good. So I turned the paper around and I said to the one, write a sentence for me. I said, here's a pen, write a sentence for me. Well, that didn't go very well. To the other one, I said, here, read me what's on this paper. Read me the top paragraph. That did not go very well either. I thought, what are we going to do with these two? So I said to the headmaster, do you want to take these two in school that are behind this far? They're grade 7 level. They're going into grade 10. And two HODs were their head of departments were in the office at the time. And I said, are you willing to take these and teach them? Because it's going to be a big project. And they all said, we'll take them. Let's take them. So I thought, okay, where does that leave me? So I said, okay, we'll take them too. So we took them to the home, got them set up, and today they actually will converse with you in English. They're reading very, very well. Kathy sent a bunch of Bible story books a number of years ago, and we read with them every day, so they're reading Bible stories. And they're teenagers, but the books have pictures in them. I just love picture books, right? But don't forget, if you've never seen a chariot before, and here's a chariot picture, you can say that's what a chariot looks like when you're reading. They know what an ox cart is, but even something like a horse, they'd never seen one, so there's a horse. So a picture book is good for their understanding. So now I'm getting to the point where I would close the book and I'd say, now you tell me the story. What did we just read? Well, it's a little more difficult comprehension, English comprehension, than it is just reading. So we're getting there. They come to Gail's class every week and learn their verse. So they're coming along nicely. Pray for them. They're Losey. They're not from the Lundulu Valley tribes that we work with. They're from a different tribe altogether. So they don't understand the languages of our area, and so English is the common denominator. So they have to pick up English this year. If they don't get above 30% on their final test, which I'll be looking at when we get back, I'll make them repeat the year. They won't be very happy with me, I'm sure. But that's our policy. If you don't pass, you repeat. So we'll see what happens. So they have worked very hard, though. Whenever they see me, they run and get their book, and they open it at the table, and we get reading. So anyway, What else? Solar system we have still on the go. Our home that we live in, plus the girls' home, are both powered with solar, with batteries and so on. Now, you have to be careful how you use your solar. If you understand solar systems at all, if you overdo it, it goes off. So you have so much electricity a day, wattage, and on a cloudy day, you don't have much. So a cloudy day, we'd tell the girls' home to turn off the fridge and not do laundry because they have a washing machine there because there's not enough power. But we're hooked to the grid now. First time in history, the Northwest Province in our area has the electricity grid. The wires have come, the poles are there. And so we're into the modern world now, finally. So we're hooked up to the system. So that means on a cloudy day, you can have power. And for those who are like Andrew, who is high tech, there's a gray box on the pole and a remote control in your hand. And as long as you've paid money on your card, you just push a button and it releases power from the box to your house. And that's how it's working. Can you imagine? In other words, you have to pay first before you get any power. But that's probably a good idea for there. Anyway, this year, or last year actually, we put new batteries in the girls' home. Drawback from solar systems are they're expensive, and it has three sets of four. And then we have another six in the kitchen, which runs the water pump. So our water and our electricity, everything is running by solar. But they're also hooked to the grid with a changeover switch. And hopefully on cloudy days, they'll be able to get the Zesco, which is like your Hydro One here. But it's prone to failure. The hospital has been hooked up for a few months with it, and fairly regularly it's not working. So it's really not very dependable, but it's at least a start. Gail's group is a wonderful group of girls that come every week, and very serious. They don't come in a lazy fashion. They always dress up to come. Believe it or not, we go early and open the door and see them coming down the streets from both directions, all dressed up, and they do their hair. They think it's a wonderful outing to come to class, to sing the gospel songs, and to learn a verse, and to listen to a Bible lesson. And it's a wonderful group, a really nice group that she has. And some, like I told you earlier, have professed to be saved. Others are still hearing the gospel. So pray for that group. They're a specialized group in the sense that they do speak English well, and they come to this class, and they're sort of accepted by the others to come, and it's we don't open it to the whole community. It's basically by invitation. In other words, we want people to come and be serious and not fool around. We don't allow any. I sit near the door, and I've never had to put someone out because they were fooling around. They're always attentive. They're always good. They always listen well. They always sing well. So I think we should be very much prayerful for that group, that truly they would know the Lord. This chart is up in the class that we use, the book room, the simplified one from Murray McLeod, I think. And so that's talked about very regularly, the Two Roads chart. And it's the class is from grade 7 to 12, so she does have quite a nice group. Gail was doing classes on the body, soul, and spirit, the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and then us, body, soul, and spirit. She was doing future events and a lot of things that they wanted to know about and wanted to think about. So. And then the next week you quiz on what you've learned the week before. So it's amazing how much they remember and how much they're learning. So it's wonderful to see them. But always the gospel there, because some of them come from outside homes and we don't see them at the gospel meeting at the assembly. I continue with a Nyamonga school, which is another school south of us. I continue going down there every week for a grade 5 to 7 class. Interesting. When it comes to those kind of outreaches, I know here we struggle with outreaches and we're kind of reluctant to give a tract and we're kind of hesitant on a lot of things. But one of the things that's really wonderful in that country is this: I can go to that school any day and have a class. I can go to that school any time and have a class. During the holidays of school, I will go. Even if it's a break, even during COVID, we had some shutdowns a few times and they said, oh, let's just go anyway. Even though if the school's locked, I would go. One of the children would come running, and they'd ding a bell, which is a metal car rim, and the children would come from all over, and at least one of them had the key, and we'd open the school and have a class. No teacher to be seen, but they're so excited about having a class no matter what day you go, they'll come, and you have 30 or 40 children come. The other interesting thing with that outreach was this. Our girls from our home, if they're not in their own school programs, can come with me. I've allowed them to come, and I always have at least one, sometimes two or three will come, and they do the interpreting, and they do the verse teaching and helping with quiz prizes and whatever. And it's really been wonderful to see their interest in that outreach. You know, we didn't beg them to come, they wanted to come, and they wanted to be part of it. So it's nice to see young people reaching out to other children with the gospel. And so we're very happy to see them getting involved with that and helping in every way. It's sort of like a spin-off. That's not the intention of that work, but the spin-off is that it helps them. In August, we had a federal election. The federal election was very peaceful, which I'm thankful to say. In some countries, it's not. Sometimes there's civil unrest and uprising, burning tires and things. And so during the election few days, we thought we better stay home and not go anywhere just in case. So we kind of kept track of it on our phones or whatever, and it actually went very peaceful. The handover of power, the one president was voted out, the new one got in, who was a professing believer. And right away he started to clean up the corruption of the country, which is quite normal in countries like that. A lot of money ends up in the pocket that should end up on the infrastructure and so on. So he's tried to do a lot. Right today he's in Dubai, actually, at a invitation of the king up there. So he's up in Dubai today, the president. So it was nice to see a peaceful handover and a gentlemanly handover of power. And the outgoing president said he was happy that God had chosen him, that he would pray for him, and we listened to it like that on the news. Very, very nice to see. So we have a new president this year. The other thing to pray about and mention is Bibles. Here, I think when we went to school, some of us are old enough to remember we got Bibles in grade 6. The little red Bibles came to school in grade 6. We all got one. Today, Bibles are not allowed in your schools, I know. It doesn't happen. But in Zambia, we give Bibles to grade 9s. By this time, they're reading English, and I always have a class with them about the Bible first, which I talk about how the Bible got to them from the very beginning, the various authors of the Bible, the books of the Bible, the sections of the Bible, the early translators, the first printed Bible we talk about, we write it on the board, and some men were actually burnt at the stake, like Tyndale and so on, for Bible interpreting. So the struggle to get a Bible in their language, in their hand, it wasn't easy. It's a long process. It took a long time. So anyway, I tell them, I don't want to see you playing football with your Bible. I don't want to see it on the floor. I don't want to see a page missing. It's precious. It's the Word of God. I want to see you reading it. Well, the one class in grade 9s had given about 35 kids per class. I came back later in the day. In the afternoon, they had an off period, and I walked through the class, and about half of them were reading the Bible I'd given them in the morning, which was kind of neat. And I thought maybe they were just doing it because they thought I was coming, but they didn't know I was coming. And I got looking, and they were all reading in a different place. So it was nice to see them taking at least a little interest in their Bible. And hopefully they will continue to do that and continue reading their Bible. We teach them to read their Bible every day, and they'll learn about God and learn about themselves and learn God's way of salvation and so on. So that's another outreach that we do for grade 9s, the giving out of Bibles. And Doug Booth from Port Hope is in charge of sending. He always sends crates of Bibles, and so we have Bibles to give out. And once in a while, a kid will say, I've lost mine. Now what do you do? A day later, I've lost mine. Well, probably they sold it or gave it to someone. So I didn't just fall off a cabbage truck. I know these things, so I just say, I only give one per student. If you want another one, you have to buy one from the book room. Well, then all of a sudden they found it again. The next day it's back in school. So you have to be kind of wise to some of the way they do things. They'll try to trick you, but you have to be very, very careful. Anyway, there's a couple of minutes left, so I've got a little song we can sing to close, but let's close in prayer. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. We appreciate your prayers for us and the work there. And as we said at the beginning, it's God's work, it's not us. We're just allowed to be part of it. Anything that gets done is his work, and he's the one doing it. So we thank the Lord for all that has happened in the last 2 years. Let's close in prayer first. Father, we just thank you for this evening that we can gather safely together and for the peace and quiet of the land here and the ability to read the scriptures and be encouraged by it and think of the words of Isaiah so many years ago about waiting upon the Lord and exchanging our weakness and our need for his strength and his ability. We just pray that we'd learn from this and be able to do this and be able to have joy and have peace in our life and be restored to that place of nearness to thee in our day-to-day life. And so we ask for your help in the workplace, in the home, and in the assembly, and every need that there is tonight represented here. We pray to meet that need and encourage us in the work of God that each one of us is called to do. So we ask your blessing upon us as we go home. Pray for safety on the roads and help us to sing a little chorus as we separate. We give thanks in the Savior's precious name. Amen. Now, I'm thinking of a song here that we usually sing maybe a Sunday morning, but if we sing two verses now, I think it's quite fitting because we're just saying that we give God the glory. If you see a picture of our home, the girls' home, BBG home, it says on the front of it, "To God be the glory." And that happened by a male student. And he said, "Oh, you have to have a sign." He said, "If you don't have a sign," this was one of our students from the high school. He said, "If you don't have a sign, people will think it's a hotel. They won't know what it is. You have to have a sign." So he kept wanting me to put a sign. He said, no, you have to have it in English, because if you have it in this language, then the other tribe won't like it. If you have it in their language, this tribe won't like it. Just leave it in English, he said. I said, oh, okay, that's fine. So I said, well, I really don't want a big sign about me. I said, this whole operation is for the Lord. I said, to God be the glory. You know, it's in your gospel hymn book. To God be the glory, great things he has done. He said, I'll make you a sign. I said, okay. You know what it says? To God be the glory. Big sign. To God be the glory. Bailey's Home for Girls. That's what it says on our front of the home. And that was his doing. Because I said, no, I don't want a big splash. I didn't want a sign. But to God be the glory. Now, 386 talks about glory to thee, thou Son of God Most High, all praise to thee. Now, like I said, I know we sing this on a Sunday morning, but if we sing verse 1, it's about being grateful to the Lord. And then maybe verse 1 and verse 5 at the close of the meeting. And verse 5 talks about our service and his love to us and the crowns that we put to his feet. So just 386 verses 1 and 5.
Glory to thee.
Jesus said, as it It was bad, yeah. It was bad.
It was terrible.
I thought I was going to be ushered from time into eternity.
Jeez, was that bad? Did you have an accident?
No, but I did get stuck a couple times. But it was crazy. Like, there's still buses stuck. Like,
I heard there were 60 GO buses stuck in today.
There's buses all over the place stuck. Transport trucks with their lights and on and ditches.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
Did you have to work with it?
That's crazy.
I drove in, and then when I got there, I was like, this is